So it's time to connect the encoder, and the first thing I do, I go into the INI file and increase the values for the F error and mean F error. It is just so I don't get a stop from Linux NC because the F error is too large. I can of course later on reduce that. And then I go into the HAL file, and do only two modifications here. This one is the important one. Here was previously some feedback from the step gen. So this is now the position feedback now comes from the encoder. There is a new signal set as well. This was not there at all before. So it says also that the velocity from the encoder is input to the feedback derivative of the position. And that is all, in fact. So, time to test. I have started the Linux CNC with the new settings. I've also set up the HAL scope here. And we will do a plus minus one pulse, as I did in part two. One, two, three, there, things will work. Yeah. And what we can see is, so the backlash is around 12 micrometers. We see vibrations. And we see the top here is plus 15, and the bottom here is over minus 20 micrometers. So we have a range here of 35 micrometers at least, and we see the backlash. So this is the baseline here. Next, I will start using the encoder to reduce the following error. All pieces are already here. It's just a method of setting the PID parameters. It's also called servo tuning, but I'm not sure if it is actually servo tuning. So it's a process of adjusting the P, I, and D parameters until there is some spontaneous oscillation, and then back off a bit. It takes some time. It's not incredibly difficult, but it's not so interesting. So I will show what I have come up with. And in the first set here is, so I have launched this calibration tool here. You can find that close to where you find the HAL oscilloscope down here in Jimokapai. And what I do, I have a setting of 250 for the P parameter, and I have the dead band. Oh, so 0.0015. So inside 1.5 micrometers, that is considered a movement inside 1.5 micrometers is considered no motion. And we have the feed forward on the velocity to 1 here. So all velocity goes straight to the output. Yeah, let's do the test here and see what happens. So if we can do 1, 2, 3, see what happened. I see what happened. Actually, the backlash went away completely, and I know there is no gap from the total max to mean on the following error is 18 micrometers, and no backlash. The vibration is there still. Not sure exactly what that is, I must say. We should compare this to the original value, of course, but before doing that, I will also show the other set of PID parameters I have come up. Here is the other set of parameters I thought was okay. So we have 300 on P, I have 10 and 0.5 on the D parameters. And let's see what happens when we do a pulse on that one. Okay, not bad, but I will want to... There. So, it's also not bad. We have the peak to peak is on the blue, on the green one, which is the way I measure, is a little bit more, 22 micrometers. But the advantage here is that if there is a remaining error, it will be slowly being taken out and reduced to zero by the I term here. I can't have very much higher value there on the I term because it's very easy to easily causes oscillations on the axis. And just for fun, I can just show you how an oscillation on the axis both look and sound like. Let's try with 1000, that is definitely too much. And we do. There we have it. Oh, I need to back off. Yeah, okay. So we can see that this causes violent vibrations on the axis. So some actual milling here. This is just an 8 millimeter carbided mill. I got 2 millimeter deep cut there. There's nothing really. It is just for fun. And let's focus now on the FR and see what happens there. And just a quick check here to see what happens when I ask, when I jog it with a MPG, yeah, you see over here, ask it to do 10 micrometers in one direction and then back. Yeah, seems perfect, there's no backlash there. Let's put the cases side by side and look at the following error. On the upper graph here, that is where it was only internal feedback, so the encoder is only used for visualization here. There we can see that there is backlash, and there is some small amount of vibrations. It's not very much, but there is still some vibrations that is recorded by the encoder. On the two lower graphs here, and that is the cases where the encoder feedback is used in a control loop. We can see that the backlash is gone. And there are two cases with different PID parameters. Both of these settings work pretty well. There are vibrations, we can see, and their amplitude is in the range of 5 micrometers. Both of these settings work. I have tested them in middling and well, and that works good. But these vibrations, where do they come from? I've done some simple impact tests with a hammer, but I cannot find any harmonics in this range that I see here. And the vibrations are around 100 hertz. But looking close at the encoder data, maybe the data from the encoder come in clusters 2 and 2. Possibly 4 and 4. That indicates that perhaps there is a reading head misalignment. This could create irregularities in the position reading, which is amplified by the control loop. When the proper M3 screws for the reading head arise, I will have a go and align the head as good as possible and as good as I can. There are tolerances for alignment, but I didn't bother with that now when I mounted it, because I knew I had to remount the head with the new screws. I will use the encoder feedback from now on and give it a test and see where see how it works in reality. The next thing to do in this project is to mount the encoder on the Y-axis and get that going.